The star of this week's webinar Wednesday is without doubt Google Calendar. Now, Google has modified Google Calendar just in a couple of subtle ways. Well, actually one fairly large way, where they've changed some features that are available to us inside of Google Calendar, and they're useful. I want to share them with you today. But they also open a rather sticky wicket. Is that right? They open a little bit of a problem for me that I consider that maybe you have as well. And that is that all of the Google accounts, depending on what type of Google account you have, they all aren't treated equally in the new features that we are going to be talking about. Google is limiting the ability in some account levels to do certain things. And they are terrible at communicating it. Their account levels I find confusing, and their explanation in how they let us know what's available in which level I don't think is particularly great either. So consequently, we're going to do two things today. One, we're going to look at the new features, which are, I think, really good. And then we're going to spend a little bit of time, and I'm going to give you a overview of the different type of Google accounts so that we can clip that out and we can recognize what type of account we have when we run into little issues. And maybe we want to change our account level. Maybe it's going to give us enough impetus to say, having some extra things might be worth me spending some money or some more money with Google if you happen to be in the Google ecosystem. So does that sound like a plan? Indeed it does. Let's dive into things, and we're going to start by talking about reminders and tasks, which Google has tweaked. So let's jump over here into Google Calendar and have a look at tasks. Now, Google has slightly modified the way that tasks happen, or they've enriched tasks while they've basically gotten rid of another feature we used to have in our calendar called reminders. Now, in the past, the two were very remarkably similar. People got confused about which one they should be using, whether you're a reminders person or a tasks person. But essentially, they both just were time-based items that let you know and reminded you of a task that you had to do, or reminded you of that particular task. Reminders and tasks. But you could do more with tasks. You could put more information in, whereas reminders were just a single line and just to remind you. So Google said, we don't really need both of those, so we're just going to go with tasks. So if you used to use reminders and wondered where they've gone and they've become tasks now. Now, we will find tasks, as with everything in the Google ecosystem, in a couple of different places. But if you look in this sidebar, the handy-dandy sidebar that Google has is incorporated now into Calendar and Mail and all of our different tools, you can. It's the one with the little blue check mark, and that is your task manager. And it's a very simple, basic task management tool. It's not as advanced as, say, an Asana or a ClickUp or some of the high-end task management tools or reminder project management tools. But it's very simple. It's just to let you know that you have this to do at this time, and it gives us nice integration in the Google ecosystem. And really, that's the benefit of using tasks, is how well it integrates with the rest of your Google system. Now, for a lot of us, as far as our own personal productivity goes, we are increasingly using our calendar as our task management tool, assigning things in our calendar based on the time that we want to have them done, instead of having us having I am on fire, instead of having a separate task management tool. I have done that. And a lot of productivity experts have poo-pooed the idea of putting tasks in calendars, and they want your calendars to be appointments. They don't want them to be task-based, so they wanted a separation of church and state as far as tasks are concerned with the calendar. That was one camp. And so I always felt guilty because I like a lot of the people that say that, and putting my tasks in my calendar, but I just find it works better for me. If I get the stuff done, that's the way I should be doing it. So for me, I was increasingly under the table, starting to use my calendar a lot more as a task manager. Now it's out in the open, and we can actually embrace and work with our calendar as a task manager. I realize I'm over-dramatizing things, but there was this division. Now, for many of us, using our calendar is the best place to put these sorts of tasks in place. And Google's new implementation makes it that much easier. And here's how it works. It couldn't be simpler. For the most part, if you're just going to be entering something into your calendar, you click on your calendar here, click on task, and then you fill in the information for the task. It can be a repeating task. You can add a description, and you can also add a list to it. You can create a list. So you can have home tasks, you can have accounting tasks, You can create new lists so you can keep your tasks in order as a task list. What a brilliant concept. How do you create new lists? Glad you asked. Go into the sidebar, click on a little drop-down menu where it tells you which list you are in, and here you can create new lists. I can create one for accounting if I needed to keep all my tasks for accounting together. And now I have three different lists, the default, home tasks, and an accounting list. And if we go back now and create a new task, we can see that I can create a task and I can put it on whichever list I want so that I can keep track. And again, this gives us a little bit of control over project management. This is simple. It's as simple as can be, but it is a shift in how we use Google Calendar. And it's a, I think it's a nice feature and it's a nice implementation. Now, this integration carries on into some other areas as well. It's going to be going through the entire Google ecosystem. So, for example, if you are in your email at any point and you decide that from your email you want to turn an email into a task, which we often do. Somebody sends us an email, there's something we have to do in it, we say, I've got to take care of that at some point. Now, we can put it, and we have been able to for a long time, take anything, any email, go into the More menu here and create an event. Create a calendar event from that email so that we know we have to deal with it. And that's great for things like appointments. We're going to meet at this point here. You take it straight out of email, put it into your calendar. It'll have all of the links for the Zoom calls or whatever. Great way to use to convert email into an appointment. But we can also convert email into a task. And we do so by looking up here into this add to tasks. Click on that and then it opens the taskbar and it will then add this email to the task with a link back to the original email, and you can set a date and a time, add some details, and you have a wonderfully crafted task ready to go out of the email. So we start to see a nice workflow that tasks facilitates for us. That's the first thing that Google has done for us, tasks, consolidating tasks and reminders, and giving us some nice new ways to do things. A couple of other things about the tasks is Google treats tasks like a separate calendar inside of your calendar. So you can actually turn on or turn off whether or not you can see your tasks inside of your calendar as you're looking at your calendar view. And if you're sharing your calendar with somebody else, if you have a shared calendar, don't worry, the tasks are never published in somebody else's calendar or their view of your calendar. So you have a certain degree of privacy with your tasks as well. The newest feature that Google is offering its calendar users is appointment scheduling. And this is, I think this is an interesting kind of, it's an interesting decision for them to have made. And it's about damn time. So for the last, I don't know, 10 years or so, we've been using different appointment scheduling tools like Calendly, a wonderful tool, Book Like a Boss, the one that I've been using for a long time. These are tools which we pay for, which allow us to publish our calendar availability to others so that we can avoid that nasty back and forth that happens by email. Do you want to get together on Tuesday? Tuesday's no good for me. How about Thursday? Thursday's good in the afternoon and you go back and forth by email and you waste so much time booking appointments and meetings. And if there's, that's just if there's two of you involved. If there's more, it gets to be an unbelievable nightmare. So these tools are worth spending anywhere between $9 and probably $59 a month in order to control and take care of your schedule. And then they added some other features to them, such as creating a landing page where you can promote other content or the ability to collect funds to be able to charge. And if you're, say, a consultant, say, if you want to book time with me, you can book time with me and pay for that time up front. So they were some really nice additional features that these tools grew into. But here was one common thing that every one of these tools had to do. Every one of these tools, scheduling appointment tools, had to have an integration going back to your calendar, to Google Calendar or Outlook would be the two that most people have, because the availability has to be found to see if you're available on your personal calendar, and it has to be booked so that you know that you have an appointment. It has to be copied on to your calendar. So there always had to be an integration back to your calendar. So I'm pretty sure somebody at Google finally said, idea, how about if we offer this service that everybody else has to link back to us for anyways? I don't know if they had that conversation, but it would seem to have been a reasonable conversation, would it not? So now they roll it out to us, appointment scheduling, with one word of warning. It's not available at every level, depending on which of your paid levels of Google, your Google account has, which we'll talk about in a moment. you may or may not have access to the calendar, to this, all of these features. Most of the accounts, though, do, including the free accounts. So let's show you, and it pretty much walks you through when you have to pay as I walk through and show it to you. Let's just get started. And how we will start is we'll just select any time on our calendar. We'll just click on our calendar, and that will open up the ability to set any regular appointment or task. But here we'll choose appointment schedule. Now, the first time we do this, we click on set up the schedule, and it then opens this dialog box that allows us to, we can give it a title, Steve's Schedule. Because you could set up a couple of different types of availability schedules should you want, because you can share this availability with others through a link, which I will show you in a moment. But here now you go through and you set your availability, and you just click plus in order to set a time range. And then you can have multiple time ranges within any one day. So we're going to say 9 to 11 on Mondays. And then we're going to add another time slot on Mondays, which is going to be 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. And I think it should just work with us just typing in without doing all the fancy zeros and colons. Yes. So now we see, if we take a look here on the calendar, that we have those two appointments available. We also have this appointment here available over here, which is where we started the whole thing, when we clicked and we started creating our first availability. So you can go through and you can set your availability this way. We'll set a full day here, and we'll say that's enough. At this, that point there, if we scroll down, we can set how far out people can set appointments with you. 60 days is the maximum length of an appointment. And you can also set up blackout periods here by adjusting your availability. Now, you don't have to worry if you happen to have an appointment set, say, on Tuesday already. Let's say that you're setting up your appointment schedule, but next Tuesday you have a dentist appointment that's already on your calendar. You don't have to worry about blocking that out yourself. It will take precedence over the availability. And so existing calendar appointments mean that you won't be available at that particular point. Somebody won't be able to book you that way. And the calendars checked for availability. It says here, any busy time on selected calendars will be automatically removed from booking. Yeah, that's exactly what I was just saying. We can do that. So it's asking which calendar we do it from. And here's the first place that you can discover that you can pay a little bit more for some more features. We have it set up to connect to one calendar to block off my availability. If I need more calendars, then I can explore spending more money with our good friends at Google in order to make that happen. So we are happy with this. You can choose the color of your calendar, and then you go next. In the next window, we can put a photo on our page, the picture that we want. We can set the location. Now, the location is, if you happen to want to have a conference call using Google Meet, an in-person meeting where you set the location, by phone call, or none to be specified later. Now, because it's Google, the other tools will give you pretty instant access if you want to, say, book it as a Zoom call instead of as a Google Meet call. But that's one of the things Google does, is they lock us off and just say you can only do this in Google Meet as far as within the calendar appointment itself. But here's a quick little workaround. You have a description field where you can give instructions to people. You can just put in your Zoom link at this point there, and at that, then they will know that they want, and then add a note, meet me here at Zoom, or on Zoom, I guess it should be. And we're ready to go. We can also add a booking form. So people have to put in their name, email address, and you can add other items should you choose. You can say, I need your phone number, or you can put a custom item in. Oh, what's your favorite team? I want to know what your favorite hockey team. It's required. It doesn't have to be that frivolous. It can be something actually useful. So you can actually set up a series of questions that you can ask people before the meeting so you can help, so you can be better prepared for the meeting. You can ask to have their email verified if you're concerned about spam. And again, if the mail is going to be verified, it's something that you're going to have to pay extra for. Speaking of paying extra, you can set up a cancellation policy or a payment plan, collecting credit card payments through Stripe. And so you have to have a Stripe account set up, and you have to purchase a premium version of your Google account in order to allow payments. But at that point there, you're really looking at it competing head on with products that you paid in the past for. So you'll be just comparing the price and comparing the convenience at that point there. And then confirmations and reminders. When somebody sets the appointment, it'll go onto their calendar. But if you want a reminder email sent out, say, an hour before to remind them that they have a meeting coming up with you, and also for you to get that email, then you have to explore other plans, again, in order to get those additional features. But once this is all done, your calendar is pretty much set up. And you get this, which will allow you to take and have a booking page that you can share with others that has your notes, how long your appointments are, and the ability for them to go in at any point and book an appointment with you. As long as you let me know what your favorite hockey team is, you can then book with me and it will appear in my calendar. So that is how the new appointment scheduling works inside of Google Calendar. Pretty slick. It's got all of the main features that you'd want. It doesn't have quite as many bells and whistles as some of the other tools, but I think this is very functional, and for the cost, free. And when you consider the fact that you're going to be linking back to your Google Calendar if you use any of those other tools, it just makes a lot of sense. I think Google's done a pretty good job with this. So, a Gmail account is a free Google account, and it provides access to your email through the @gmail.com address. It was originally introduced, believe it or not, back in 2004. It's 20 years old. And I remember when you had to have an invitation to join it. It took a little while to get the invitation to be able to join. But over time, Google has evolved it. It was beta for the longest time. And they started using it as the basis to integrate their apps like Google Docs, Sheet, Slides, the other Google apps. And you can also access other services with your Gmail account. It gives you access to pretty much everything, like photos and maps and YouTube. And some people even forward their email, their work email, to it for convenience. But unlike the Google Workspace accounts that we'll be talking about in a moment, a Gmail account is managed just by you. It's an individual account. A Gmail account is just for you. It's solely for an individual user. Now, a Google account is an account that gives you access to your different Google applications, like Docs, all the different Docs, Google Slides, Google Sheets, etc., or Google Photos, but it doesn't need you to use a @gmail.com address. In other words, you could use your own. I could use my dottotech.com address in order to sign in. So it doesn't do my Gmail, but it does everything except for Gmail, basically. Again, it's free and it's for individuals to use. It's an individual account. That's a Google account. Gmail account, Google account. Very similar, but Gmail account gives you Gmail and ends in @gmail.com. Now, Google Workspace has a range of different editions for different organizational needs. Basic, business, enterprise. It used to be called G Suite. And these accounts, the difference between these accounts and your Gmail account is it's managed by administrators. So there's an administrative access, so you can provide access to shared documents, shared files, shared storage, that kind of stuff. So it gives you access to all of those things, as well as different access to different tools like we're just looking at inside of, say, the scheduling tools are different at different levels within the Google Workspace account. Now, one of the other big deals that Google Workspace gives you is the ability to use your own email address instead of a Gmail address. This is why they're great for corporate work or for small businesses. So if your business is named Small Business Steve, you can have your email address @SmallBusinessSteve. That's a stupid name, I know. But that's basically the Google Workspace account, which is administered by an individual administrator, or by an administrator, not by the individuals who have access to the accounts. Good Gmail account administered by you individually. And that's probably the kind of the nuts and bolts of the different types of Google accounts. I hope I cleared that up for you.